was Troy, 3,000 years ago, a city of destiny. So situated that it dominated the Hellespont, today known as the Dardanelles. This was the only sea route to and from the east. As a result, Troy grew prosperous, a tempting prize of war for the Greek nations. The Trojans had long memories of the time when the Greeks, led by Sparta, had pillaged and burned the city of their fathers. They had prepared strong defenses against the possibility of future assault. That is why New Troy, their rebuilt city, was guarded by mighty walls, an impregnable shelter for a happy people in love with beauty. In the palace square and the busy streets, the industrious citizens were enjoying the works of peace, as though this carefree era would last forever. There was Lord Aeneas, nephew of King Priam, on his way to the palace, where the future of Troy was being weighed by the royal council.
And so we've locked out the understanding of nations. And we've locked in the poison. Trojans chopping at every rumor, pointing fingers at each other. I tell you, there's only one solution.
Have your way. Go to Sparta. Go wherever you will.
But don't try to drag the destiny of Troy with you.
What destiny? To live like a crab in a shell?
We live well. We tax the traders at the sea gate. That's our blood.
Stupidity. We'll choke on our own fat unless we sail our own ships of trade.
But how
can we? When every harbor is an enemy's.
Oh, I'm sick of your crazy dreams.
Careful, brother. Paris has always been able to crack your neck.
Then you can thresh us both.
Tell him he's a fool, Hector.
My sons. The fool is the man who makes a quarrel over debate. Paris, I bless your plan to sail to Sparta. I know that I can trust you not to beg for peace.
I'll simply try to convince the Greeks that our power makes a treaty advisable.
I'd convince them. I'd take 100 ships of war and burn the soil of Sparta black.
I'm sure you would, Polydorus, and create endless war. And you, Hector, do you aspire to anything but to excel at swordplay and boxing?
Yes, sir. The javelin and the discus.
Ah.
Hector's a good son, Priam.
And a good husband, my lord. Is that not sufficient glory?
By your leave, sire, the ship of Paris is ready to sail.
Do the gods approve the day and the hour?
The omens are good, my king, and also the prophecies. With but one exception. One troubled priestess of the temple.
My daughter.
Don't be angry, Priam. Cassandra is ill.
Sick in the mind. Arise, Paris, and go.
The virgin Cassandra does make one point that causes me much concern. Prince Paris, it appears, gives all his worship to one goddess alone. Aphrodite.
I'm not sure I worship anything. Now, admiration is the better word. Admiration for the beauty of a marble image.
It was not the goddess of beauty who taught us to arm against our enemies, but Athena, the goddess of wisdom, and the patroness of the horses of war. Athena does not rejoice in this solitary adoration of yours. Neither is she delighted, my prince, that you undertake a mission of peace.
And I suppose that evil horse of hers will spring out and trample me. Very well. Let it come, my lord. If that's the price of living in a world of fables.
Do not say that, Paris. Do not seek peace elsewhere, dear brother. Until first you have pacified Athena.
My little Cassandra, there can be no postponement. So come along, and give me your blessing for a happy voyage.
I cannot bless what I see in your future, Paris.
Cassandra! Cassandra, stop this.
But, Father, it's true. What I see and feel is true.
Go, Paris.
Come, Cassandra. Come and rest a while.
How can I, Mother? Why, wish it hadn't been given me this agony I live with.